where I had to coach the local ski jumping club. And I hated the alpine equipment because it was so clumsy to walk in and to work with small kids. So I started to put ski jumping equipment onto the alpine skis, and that's the way how I entered the telemark skiing. After a couple of years being a coach, I noticed that in Switzerland, you would believe, there is a world championship scene in something which is called telemark skiing, and that's my first real contact with the telemark. Of course, I went there, and everything else is history. I've also made the Slovenian telemark team, did a couple of races, and I'm also the member of the FS telemark committee. So I don't know how many of you guys are actually involved, or you know that there is a race. There is some body for telemarking, but here I am in flesh. So, as one of the representatives from actually also many other countries which are represented at the same time. Enough about me. Here is Robert Aleš. He is our boss, but he lacks a little bit of the language skill. So we've decided that the shop will be actually ran by me. However, Aleš is a key person in our organization because he's also a writer, and we are really proud that after about 10 years we have a second book written about telemark skiing in Slovenia. This of course is not an end version, but the idea of this book is to actually give all the information how to become a very good telemark skier. It is in a concept very similar to what our colleagues from Switzerland presented us yesterday, but we have nicer pictures in it. Of course, we do. Come on. We also have messages that you maybe just go through it. Because, as I said, this is the working version. It's not out yet. It's due to be in December, so just in front of this year's Northern Hemisphere winter. Okay, so Aleš here is the author. He was also involved in racing because he has two, he has more, just two sons, but two of them are actually racing also on the World Cup. So he's also very involved in that. Why I'm talking so much about racing? Because in Slovenia, the ski school in generally does not have the idea of having a tourist which will come to your resort, but we are more oriented that kids which start to do some kind of sport, they start to be the best possible skiers in the world. I don't know if this is the most appropriate way to approach the sport which has so much uniqueness as telemark has, but that's the way it is. However, the book here is not how to make a world-class racer, it's more like how to become a world-class skier. So we try to show with very, how should I say, biomechanical model of skiing, so that everything has some kind of science behind it, and we take these lessons out from the racing life and we employ them into that book. So that's the general idea of this book. This, if I may just steal this one, this is the Slovenian version of the Swiss table you had. It is very similar, although that I must admit I like the way they presented it yesterday quite well. It's really good. Okay, so today we're gonna face three, what we call it, I mean, again, we have the family of the turns, and we are talking now carving turns, and we kind of developed or divided these turns into three categories. So the first category is the category where the skier does a lot of angulation and inclination while doing a carving, okay? The second category is when the skier actually goes without any inclination and without any angulation. He just leans into the turn, but not like to the inside, just following the same angle as the ski on the edges. Yeah. Yes, exactly, exactly. And then the third one is actually with a lot of lateral movement. So instead of going up and down to release the pressure from the skis, we are trying to push the skis away from your body, and you are basically just going like this. And the most of these techniques can be very easy, also used on the average day of skiing. It's just that we feel that if you have a nice and gentle slope, you can actually have a really good feeling from the ski. You can feel the edge, that's the most important thing. And once you feel it, then you can also feel the very concentrated forces which are generating through your actions on the snow. And that's why we are using carving as a tool, okay? Of course, it's a lot of fun to carve, as Bastien here will probably be very supportive of. But, yeah, we are using that just as a tool. Now, I know that you are a very good skiers, but please allow me also to talk a little bit about the equipment we are using. Okay, of course we are all standing on the skis and we have very, very different skis. And now because you have the cameras and I am sponsored by Elan, I need to show you my skis. So what is so special about the skis, the modern ski? Of course we have the side cut. And the way the side cut actually works is once you apply the pressure onto the ski, and the ski is of course touching the snow, because of this side cut, it's actually flexing and doing some kind of circular shape. So basically what we are doing is this, okay? And the more you can flex the ski, the more you can put the pressure on, the more the ski will turn. I think that is logical to everybody. Now we have very different skis, from powder skis to the, I don't know, whatever you have. But they all have this same characteristic. Regardless if you go skiing onto the off-piste, onto the deep snow, you will have, of course, flat skis, but they will still have a side cut, and they will still work the same way. Even in the soft snow, you are not getting support from the edge, you are actually getting support from the surface, but the principle of operation is the same. So that is why carving, at least we believe so, could be used as a very good tool to teach you how to ski better. Okay, now let's talk less. There is no more cue. Let's hit the slope. We have a tendency to do one exercise or one concept of exercises to get people a feel for an edge. And the first exercise is actually quite simple. We will try to do just a turn on the edge. Actually, not a turn. We'll just pass. Now it's a language barrier, sorry. So if we have a fall line, are you all familiar with the term fall line? You know what it means?
Yes.
Okay, a very simple explanation is, if you take a ball and you roll it down the slope, the ball would go some path, and that's the fall line.
Yeah.
Okay, so if you ski down the fall line, you will go faster and faster and faster. Okay, so that's cool if you're a racer, but we are now on the beginner phase, so we will start here and we will just do a basically cross over the fall line, okay? But when we do that, we will try to concentrate on the position, and I'm not talking here the position because generally yesterday what the Swiss guy said, just copy paste, that's it, we have exactly the same thing. The only thing I would maybe stress a bit more is that we like to say that our body weight position should be approximately on the heel of the front foot. That's it. Not too much to the back, not too much to the front, approximately there. But the concept is exactly the same as yesterday described by the Swiss guys. So I will not lose time. So now we are in this telemark position, and what we would like to achieve is that you just use your edge while going across the slope. Yeah, one more thing. We do have a tendency to say people that we should have skis a little bit more apart. Better a little more apart as too close together. Okay?
At the beginning.
Yeah. Yeah, cool one point.
At the edge of which
Sorry?
At the edge of the outside skis.
Yeah, the lower one.
Yeah.
So basically what you do is you set the telemark, and of course, because you are doing that on the flat terrain, the first you just slide and then you go a little bit steeper terrain, and what you do is you're trying to edge a little bit. So you're not really doing any other movement, anything, you just try to edge a little bit like this. Okay? Robert is also saying that I should stress that our position generally, we start when we go from the basics, we start with the man standing upright like this. So you have your feet like you have, not close together like this, and not as far apart as this. So we are just here, stable position, and then we start to do our stance. Okay, let's try to find a little bit better terrain down there to do this first exercise. So, I'm trying to set in the telemark like this, and then just I'm of course stopped by the terrain. Yeah, you can try, guys. You can do that with any kind of ski, regardless of the fatness of it.
Separation?
Yeah. So, that's one of the types. There is a static exercise we are doing quite often, Robbie. Because with this one, the people which are usually having a lot of problems with the thrust, because the people don't trust the ski. They need to get the thrust into their ski. So what we use a lot in this respect is to show them how much they can actually do. This is that you have started usually without this. Then you have a guy and he's holding he's holding his hands stretched out, and then he's leaning towards the inside of the turn. Okay, lean in. Okay, and I'm holding him. Okay, what he is trying to achieve here is to get a feel where the pressure builds. So he is actually trying to push onto the front ski the most. And the idea of this exercise is that the student doesn't fall to the inside of the turn, and he feels that if he can push with all of his power to the front ski, the ski will, the edge will grab and hold his body. Okay, you can see it now. Okay, he can also experiment with different telemark positions. Okay, he can also go lower and lower and lower like this. Of course, it depends how much I hold him. Okay, good.
Good.
Yeah. Okay. Now push this one a little bit more to the back.
Do
you get more power to this one?
Yeah.
You feel there is more strength.
I'm also more turned than ever you should be, but I mean, in my
opinion. At the moment, yes, yes, of course. But this is the point of the exercise that you get. Okay, I'll do this a little bit louder. So we just had a small conversation here, and the comment was that you are more turned, that you have more angulation, etc., etc. Yes, you have more angulation as usually while you ski, but you also have all of the powers which are happening while you are moving very concentrated. And that's what we are searching. That's the idea behind, because as I said, our model is biomechanical model for which we believe it's right. And it doesn't say you have to be in this and this position, but it says you need to create this and this power. So how to simulate those power is, of course, the tricky thing. And as long as you don't feel, and the feeling is everything in telemark, as you know it. So as long as you cannot feel your body, as long as you cannot feel what is actually happening, you cannot really do the skiing.
Urban.
Sir.
Do you have a target for the angle of the back femur?
Yes. Our idea is that the back femur should be between the two positions. So we are not having a one position, but we are having two, front and back. The front one is this one, so that you have the knees completely together. And of course, may I use you, the Norwegian guy? Could you please show me this position with the very, very, knees together, like this. And now, just stand upright, please. Okay. Yeah, like this. So you are stable, are you? Please close your eyes. Okay. If I push this guy, what is happening? Yeah. What is happening? He's crashing. So this is definitely the front barrier. Sorry.
No,
so,
it's good demonstration.
I expected this. Yeah.
Okay.
For the picture.
Yeah.
Back of the head again. Back of the head.
Okay. Oh. So this is for us. This is the most front position. Because if you go with the knees more as this, already in this position you are completely unstable. Okay. And then we have a second position, which is that the femur should be with the skis about 90 degrees. So if you have a large stance like this, yeah, it's still the same theory. And with this, we believe that you still have some kind of control of the back of the ski. If your stance is a bit closer, then your position could be higher up. And that has a lot to do with the way you ride. Because I personally, I do ride with really big stance usually, yeah? And that's why I need to go into the more energy consuming position. If you would, for example, see Bastien, I know how Bastien skis, and his feet are usually quite close together, but he's having hips higher up because of that, and that's how he can create more leverage towards the snow. And more leverage means more grip, more power onto the skis. That's the idea behind it.
But the idea is, if we have the fall line, you start it up with just simple crossing of the fall line, then you add the starts on the fall line and crossing, and then the final solution would be start on the fall line, crossing, and then go to the next direction. You need to have nice flat terrain, not too steep, as because if you are using the carving, you know that the speeds will be higher. So if you will go on the terrain which is too steep, the student cannot control anything anymore and everything is in vain. So it's very important to use the proper terrain for this kind of exercises.
Ivan, can we maybe ask a question?
Sure.
You talk about
lots of weight on the front.
Correct.
Okay. Most weight on the front ski?
As we said, we are not concentrating on most or least or etc. It comes with the terrain. Okay, so if you would go, for example, on the flat terrain, then you would have more on the both feet. If you would go into the extreme steepness, then you will have more onto the front feet. But as the idea is generally very similar to what we have been presenting yesterday, because the idea is you have the ski, and the ski, if the ski tip is in the snow, then the ski tip is start to flex. That means you are having control over the steering part of your turn. And if you are to the back, then your ski tip is up in the air, and you maybe have a feeling that you are carving like hell, but you are basically not. Yeah. So that's it. And there is also one more very important thing. Once you go into the very advanced stage of carving, there is a lot of people reporting that they accelerated out of the turn. That is very dangerous. Because what they do is they are in the front position and then they shift the body weight position to the back and they think that they accelerated like hell. And that happens a lot, especially if you go and see racing. you will see the guys will start to turn in the front and it will end like this on the S.
And that's not fast.
Sorry?
It's not good.
No, it's not good, because basically what you are doing, you are creating a stick out of your ski, and you are basically skiing like this, with one ski like in front of you, and this is actually causing more drag as if you would just use it on the edge. But that is already too...
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, but what...
I guess too steep, and I turned. I believe you said weight towards the heel of the front foot.
Correct.
Right there. This is little here, like in our drill where we pull on the poles.
Okay.
Mechanically, what is the purpose of the back leg or back ski?
Basically, you have to have a counterbalance.
That's what I was wondering. I sometimes think
basically,
it's just the counterbalance.
Yes, yes. Because you have no ability.
So that I don't do that.
Correct. You have no ability to control your front movement. So you would basically nose plant if you wouldn't have something to counteract. Uh-huh. And you actually are never completely 100% on the front ski. You always have some tension onto the back ski. But I never said any percentage. I never said how much. Never. Because that is really up to the terrain.
As this foot, if it comes forward, I lose my counterbalance.
And that is exactly why. And that is exactly why we don't like you to see skiing like this. And here you can have another thing. If you remember yesterday's lesson by the Swiss, you have less than one foot space. And this is maybe a little bit from the racing part, but this is some idea that we should have at least one foot space of a gap between the heel and the toe. So even if you want to have, for example, as I said, knee to the knee, then this would be probably your position. It works sometimes. Yeah? But again, if you have the rider which want to ski the full day, then he would most probably want to ski up here, because this position is comfortable. And he will not have all that hard work with going up and down and so on. But if you have a racer who only has 2 minutes to ski, then he will probably try to push as much as he can into the edge so that he will get the most acceleration, etc., etc. But the concept is the same for both riders. Okay, so here we go. And okay. One more time. Yes, what you have skied was like this. Okay, so the knee is always in front of the other knee. And that is something which I definitely not characterize as Telemark. And what happened was also that your stance was wider than longer, if you understand what I mean. So this is actually very dangerous to face plant. Okay, so what we would do in this position, is first chill out, okay? Step a little closer together and do a little bit of a stance. Okay? Good. One more exercise on this particular topic. I hope that we can do it. Is that you use your poles, okay? You're holding the poles in front of you. And because on this particular agenda, we are trying to get the angulation, we are trying to get the inclination. So what we are doing is we are putting the poles down the hill. So they are always 90 degrees to the pole line, let me call it that way, okay? But the arms should be stretched out the whole time, don't do this, okay? I usually, when I do the demonstration, I can also do the demonstration like this, and I'm holding my
poles up here so that the people behind me can see it better. Okay? But I want you to do it in front.
What does the line mean? So it's always like...
Yes. The sticks should always be like this.
So if I'm like this and the pole line is like this, then I'm standing like this.
Yes. So and then when you're gonna turn, the sticks will not move. If you are riding, the sticks are always like this. They should be fixed, like a steady cam. Okay? Understood?
Yeah.
He's constantly reminding me these are only the exercises, yeah? Because once you are really riding it, you will never have that much extra accelerated moves. Anna Preisenhagen.
Cool.
Keep going, gang.
Keep going, gang. You can also turn the other direction.
Okay,
I have a question.
Sure.
It's not unclear, but I'm just more like curious. Obviously, for recording, we expect them to have some, you know, basic knowledge of the stamp.
Yes, of course.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
But don't you think that the risk with an exercise like this is really to, obviously, if I do it a lot, there's a moment where the foot will get, and we saw with some people that the step then gets shorter. And so where do you go? Is it just to show like the extremes, basically, and try it out, the extremes, or?
That is precisely what the problem is. If you are having the group or a candidate which is not up to the challenge, and I agree with you 100% on this one. So as I said at the beginning, this is just a tool, and you need to be careful how to use it, right? Because what is happening here is, if you are over exaggerating some of the movements, then some other mistakes will start to appear. However, with our experience, and if you are having here, then you can basically get people to a feeling. I'm not trying to educate a full professional carver down here. I'm trying to get a guy which is here to get to here. Okay, understood. Okay, the next should I say part of the family is the carving without any angulation and any inclination. So basically, we are skipping the upper part of the body. We are trying to fix it, and we are having it 90 degrees towards the ski line. Okay, and here like a stick from the ski up. So you will say, okay, but how can you turn it? What kind of forces would you have? What we are trying to achieve here is higher speed, and with the higher speed you will have more power, centripetal power, which will do the work, the load, instead of you. On this particular model, you will also notice that there will be less movement with or playing with up and down, etc. You will basically shift. Of course, you have to release the pressure, but because you are not building it with any of your movement, you will basically just make your full inclination less, and the power will be less on the ski. Does that make a sense? It's a little bit of a language barrier here on my side. Did you got the concept for it?
The concept is certainly not to break at any point in the...
That is correct.
That is correct. One stick.
Okay, we do have a couple of exercises, and Robert will demonstrate one which we are calling the motorbiker. So, motorbiker Aleš. We are having again sticks, which are now, as opposing to what we did before, they are always 90 degrees on the skis. Okay,
and you are riding basically the motor. Next exercise, what we do is so-called aeroplane. Yes. The aeroplane does require a little bit of space around you because it looks something like this. You're trying to imitate the wings of the aeroplane. You heard me before saying that we have everything in the biomechanic and science, etc., etc., etc. And what I'm trying to say here is that we are trying to implement science with some funny exercises. So we give them nice names like aeroplane, like motorbiker, something which can maybe everybody connect with some kind of visual appearance of the object we are talking about. So
they povej, da tele bistvo, ono, da se s palco dotakneš
tega
hriba, se nagneš, nekako začutiš.
The aeroplane also has another orang pokaže telemark. The aeroplane has also another purpose. It gives you a little bit of awareness in the three-dimensional space, because the aim of this exercise is actually that you touch the snow with the inner ski pole. However, be careful not to do this. Not the German way. Where is the German? Okay?
I disagree with this statement.
Okay. Okay, let's try it on.
Canadian the best.
Huh? Really?
Yeah.
Super. It's too much in crying.
Okay. That would be our next exercise. Of course, the final thing, but I don't think that to go with really, really, really fast speed down these slopes will do any good in the conditions we have at the moment. So I will basically break here and give you just a theory on the next exercise, and we're gonna go back and forth a little bit. We'll go now with that chair to the top, and the chair at the top is quite steep, okay? So what I will try to implement there is to do the lateral changing. What does that mean? If we just look the position of the skier, it will look something like this. We will be in a telemark position, and then we will, by the change, pay attention now, go down, do the change, and then we will build the pressure with standing up. Okay? So we will, this is the way we see it. Yeah? Okay? So what will actually happen on the slope is, if this is the turn, like this, okay? The change is usually somewhere here, okay? Because this is the change of direction. So somewhere in this area will be the change. So this is the position where I'm going to be the lowest, okay? When I will go on over the fall line, on the fall line, I will be stretched out the most as I can. I will need to build a lot of pressure, and I need to use the skills which I've learned with the motorbiker exercise. So I need to bring the ski on the edge. If you need to slow down because of the speed, where will you do that?
Finish the turn.
That is exactly the wrong thing.
Okay?
Why? Just use the logic. If you are watching, I don't know, Formula One cars or motorbike GP car guys, yeah? What do? They're on the straight and they go full power, and then they come to the corner. So what do there? At first, they brake. So they slow down, slow down. Once they feel they can manage the turn, they put full power in. And that is exactly what we are doing in the racing, at least in the theory. So you would maybe slow down from here, from the change to some point here. Once you will feel comfortable, you will be able to ride the full turn. You will just go on the edge and use the power of the ski and the geometry of the ski. That's the principle we are teaching.
Could you explain how we're slowing down here again?
Sliding.
That is drifting.
Drifting, correct. And the point is, because you basically have two forms. You have either drifting or you are on the edge. But what does this kind of exercise has to do with the general skiing? Well, imagine the moguls. How would you ski the moguls? Well, what I am tending to do is, I'm hitting the mogul. I am basically putting my feet on the top of the mogul. I'm putting them together, okay? And then I'm trying to slide to the next one. It's less of the carving bit. It's more of this sliding bit, but the principle of operation, if I may say so, is the same, because the movement is like this with your feet. Okay?
Whereas the tall carving brez kucel.
Yeah.
A ne možno po kuclih brez kucel.
Yeah. So he's just saying, he was a competitor also in the moguls, and he just said that he feels that the carving is basically like riding the moguls without the moguls. Okay? So let's try that. Why did I say that I'm gonna give you the lesson on this now? Because up on the top is quite steep terrain. And for me, it's one of the easiest techniques to get down the slope and look cool and look fast and everything and be completely in control is actually using that technique. Okay? Let's go up there and see if I will make. Pay attention that you try to build up the pressure once you do the change. It's kind of logical, eh? So when you are stretched out, there should be a pressure. Then you collapse, do the change, and here you have to build the pressure, especially on the front ski, as much as you can. Okay? Exactly why I wanted to call you. The key difference between the first two or the first exercise and this one is the way we put the pressure onto the ski. So at the first one, we are first trying to get a full support out from the snow. As you remember, if you recall a little bit, when we start, we just started with easy transition across the fall line, and we were focusing on the angulation, on the rotation of the upper part of the body, and trying to set an edge into the snow with the goal that we get a support from it. Okay? That was kind of logical. What was then the next logical thing? The next logical thing was that we actually released the pressure. With releasing the pressure, we got the ability to actually start to steer, either to go edge to edge, either to go into the sliding, doesn't really matter, as long as you go quickly up and you release that tension from the ski, then you can do something with it, okay? But then, it was again, the same principle, we started to push on the ski so that we will get that pressure back on the edge. And here is exactly the opposite. So what we are trying to do is still that we release the pressure from the ski, but the way we are building it is the vice versa. Because we are trying to use the centrifugal force which we are getting into the turn, and we are trying to push the ski into the snow with standing up. Okay? And then at the end of the turn, the ski will be bent, will be flexed, and it will give us some extra kick. And this kick, you just say, now, okay? And it will. And when you decide to say now, this will result in quick change of leaning feet, and the skis will be acting as a spring.
will then turn the skis to the other direction. Now again, if you're gonna slide or if you're gonna set an edge, doesn't matter, but then you will start to push against the snow again. Okay, so the key element by the both exercises is to find that support. If you ask me how to do that, I don't bloody know. Okay, it's about the feeling. That's the difference. That's what it makes good skier or a bad skier to set them apart. That's the idea.
Še povedi, to dobro začeti v ožjem hodniku, ne zelo na širok, a ne?
There is one more thing. Thank you for the reminder. With all these exercises, as I said, we need to build the trust, because of course, what we are trying here, I expect you to be on some certain level, and I'm just giving you some ideas, okay? But if you would be my group, which I would coach, I would definitely stay on the flat terrain, so that we will have nice, easy, gentle slope, and then we would start the turns very slowly, and then we will go bigger and bigger, and then all the way across, if you would be able to do that. So always go from a small thing, try to develop the feeling, the support of the ski. Now I got it, now I can play with it. And as long as you start to play, you will see it goes almost naturally left and right. I would like to hear some of your comments, if you have any, on these particular topics we just covered here. I don't know, I will just start here. Any ideas, what you share, what are your feelings about the... Any? No?
I agree with you.
Oh, okay. Just like my wife.
You need to be working the other way around.
Fred? Yeah, I mean, interesting approach to the
that while you will see it, this whole movement will be very, very short, as short as possible.
Okay.
Yeah.
That means the last movement to put down, you can give us one more demo with the realistic one.
I will try to, but if I go and try to keep carving down here, then I might crash.
Okay, never mind.
Yeah. I know that you know. But yes, of course.
Line of fall line, and your boss do before the
entering the fall line.
Yeah. So what for this exercise? What
would you suggest?
The point is you have to concentrate on when where the start of next turn starts. So the philosophy behind this is if you have two turns, okay, here is the change of the direction. That's exactly where your transition must be done. Now, he did a change a bit differently as I did. Mm-hmm. And that was the reason why it maybe appeared that he was doing it a bit more here, and I maybe a bit more here.
Okay, but yeah. Both are correct.
We don't say that there is correct or incorrect. As I said, the idea behind the applications we have here is to give you some space, because, for example, my bone is much larger than your bone is, so logically if you have the same angles, if we start to be very scientific, then my body weight position by the same angle would be way more back as yours because of the length of the bones. So it's ridiculous to say only this form is the right one, but it's very smart to have area and
a range.
Exactly.
But as far as demonstrating the exercise, would you recommend doing that lead change before reaching the fall line, or would you say
yes,
it's
definitely yes?
Okay,
definitely
that was more of the question.
Yeah,
Okay. And do you discuss with each telemark anything that has to do with the rotary aspect of things?
Yes, it's called the basic turn, and as I said,
the carving here was just exercise for us. I assume that you know about that, so I didn't spend time on it. But yes, we have a basic turn, and if we go down into the shack, and I can give you a book and we can just go through, because there are in every, that's what is beauty of our book, we have pictures for everything what we do. So not only the text is very descriptive with to do, 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 but then you also have pictures so you can see how it works. Yeah. So the main focus or the main stress of our tool or our approach is that we always have some of the twist of the upper part of the body and some of the angulation. Not too much and not too little, just the right amount. Of course we do have exercises which are more or less for that, as we saw two extremes just before. And yeah, that's about it. Okay, let's ski some more so that we don't get cold. What's the time like? If somebody has a watch?
Almost one.
So until when do we have the clinic?
Yeah.
Pitches in. Okay, 5 past 1.
Five.
So we have like time for one more run if you go fast, yeah? Mm-hmm. Let's do some skiing, come on now.
Are we getting on the lift here?
There is one more exercise which we didn't really cover, and we can make one more down here if you want to. That would be that you combine the alpine and the telemark technique. Why alpine and how to do that? Alpine because if you are not in the balance point, in the balance position, then you will definitely have issues, then you will definitely have troubles, and you will have to find the right position for it. So what we usually do is two types of exercises. Either we go one turn alpine, one turn telemark, and again, one alpine, one telemark. Or we go alpine, alpine, telemark, telemark. So decide which one you want to take. I give you that freedom, and let's try that on. You can clearly feel the conditions on the slope are quite soft. So that actually calls for a little bit less of some extra power. So in this case, we would probably use less of that angulation and so on. And we would use more